All right, so good morning everybody. Welcome to lecture 7 of quantum mechanics. So we have been talking about the infinite potential well, right? And as I was just discussing with Aarti, there should be a factor of I over here when we take this difference. But this factor of I, which is square root of minus 1, is present in every state, right? So by the way, did you all work out this integral?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any difficulties?
No, sir.
Okay. So this factor of I is there in front of every basis state, right? So first of all, if you want to write down any state of the system, right? So, okay. So what we have done is so far is in the infinite potential well, we have found the energy eigenvalues, the momentum eigenvalues, and the exact form of the basis state, right? And we have normalized them. Normalization gives us a factor of root 2 by L, right? And let's look at a few of these solutions. What do they look like? So if you make a plot of these solutions, if you set n is equal to, what is the smallest value? N is equal to 1. Okay. What do you get? You get this thing, right? Why? Because you just get, so this is x is equal to 0, x is equal to L, you just get root 2 by L sine pi x by L, right? So for x is equal to 0, you get sine 0. For x is equal to L, you get sine pi, right? So it goes from 0 to pi. For n is equal to 2, you get root 2 by L sine 2 pi x by L, right? So now going from 0 to L means that you're going from the argument varies from 0 to 2 pi, right? So what does your state look like? It's basically one complete oscillation, right? And I'm just drawing this vertically. That doesn't mean that the states are shifted upwards. Okay, they are all lying, or you know, this is x, this is psi of x, let's say. So all of our states are here only, right? So this is n is equal to 1, n is equal to 2, then n is equal to 3 will look like this, right? So each time what happens is that, so what are these? These are waves, right? These are sinusoidal oscillations, right? What kind of waves are these? Do you know? If you just think about these as waves and not as some quantum objects, what kind of waves are these?
So standing waves.
They're just standing waves, right? They're standing waves. So what is a standing wave? A standing wave is when you have nodes at the ends of the box, right? So if you have a box, some container, right? And I tell you that the box is closed at both ends. And I ask, well, what are the standing waves? The length of the box is L. So the first standing wave would correspond to half a wavelength, right? So half a wavelength means here you have one node at x is equal to 0. Here you have the second node at x is equal to L. Right? So you get L is equal to lambda by 2, which tells you that lambda is equal to 2L. Right? And from this, you can work out, if you work out P is equal to H by lambda, right? So H by lambda is equal to H by 2L, right? And what is K? K is equal to P divided by H bar, right? I hope that you remember this. So what is P divided by H bar will give me 2 pi H over H 2L. So you'll get K is equal to pi by L, right? What did we get for here? We got N pi by L, right? The solution for KN. So for N is equal to 1, what is K? K is pi by L, right? So these are just standing waves. The next standing wave will be when you have a full wavelength, right? When you have lambda is equal to L. Then you have lambda is equal to 3 halves L, and so on. So lambda is equal to N plus 1 half times L. Right? And this will give you exactly the same relationship that you have here. All right. Now, what about the energy eigenvalues? The energy eigenvalues, N square, H square, this is fine. So this is H bar square. So H bar square, if I write it as H by 2 pi, I'll get H square. The pi will cancel. Pi square will cancel, and I'll get N square H square by 8 mL square. So this is another way to write it. So the energy eigenvalues look like this, right? N square H square over 8 mL square. So if I make a plot of these eigenvalues, right? So this is En. Let's say this is N is equal to 1. I get E0 is H square by 8 mL square, right? Then let's say what is N is equal to 2? So this should be E1. E2 is going to be N square. N square is 4, right? So I'll just get 4 times E0. What about N is equal to 3? N is equal to 3 will be, E3 is going to be how much? 9 E0, right? So these are the allowed energy eigenvalues. What does that mean? That means that the system, that a particle can only have these energies, right? What is the lowest energy eigenvalue? That is E1, right? And this is called the ground state. Right? For obvious reason, because ground state means it's like you are in a building, right? So this is the ground floor. Then you have the second floor, like this. And then you have the third floor. So between these floors, right? So if you imagine that you are in this building and you have a lift which is taking you up and down, can the lift stop between n is equal to 1 and n is equal to 2? Can any passengers get down from the lift in this region?
No, sir.
No. That means that your particles can never have an energy in these regions, right? So your particle can only have an energy which is n is equal to 1 or 2 or 3 and so on. Now, so that means that your energy is quantized, right? It is discrete. Your energy eigenvalues are discrete. Now, if you have a just give me 1 second, okay? Okay, so I'm back. So energy is quantized, you have discrete eigenvalues, right? Now, if you remember for the free particle, right, when there is no potential at all for the free particle, the energy can take any value because it is equal to h bar k square over 2m. And what are the allowed values of k? K belongs to the real line, right? So any real number gives you a value of K. So here, the energy spectrum is not quantized, it's continuous. Right? And imagine that you have a particle now in this system, okay? And so this axis represents the energy. Okay. Now, let's say that the particle starts out in the n is equal to 1 state, right? And I send in a photon. Okay, I send in a photon. The particle absorbs the photon, let's say, right? So when the particle absorbs the photon, the energy of the particle after absorbing the photon becomes, so let's say this is E is equal to h nu, right? This is Planck's expression, right? For the energy of a photon, where nu is the frequency of the photon. So what is the energy of the photon what is the energy of the particle after it absorbs the photon? It will be E1 plus h nu, right? Now, what are the allowed values of E prime? Right? Can E prime be equal to 2E1? Huh? Vikas, you are nodding your head. Can E prime be equal to 2E1?
No, sir.
No. What can it be equal to? E prime can only be equal to En, where n is greater than 1. Right? So what does that tell us about the energy of the photon? It tells us, so En, where n is greater than 1, is equal to E1 plus h nu, which tells us that h nu, the energy of the photon, is En minus E1, where n is greater than 1. Right? What will happen if my photon's energy does not satisfy this relationship? So let's say I send in a photon, and photons are generally represented by the letter gamma. So let's say my energy of the photon, E gamma, right, h nu, is not equal to En minus E1. And I send this photon towards my system, what will happen?
It won't be absorbed.
Well, right. But you are saying that very quickly because you might already be familiar with the ideas of quantum mechanics, right? Will not be absorbed, right? So if somebody is not familiar with the framework of quantum mechanics, you might think, your first instinct might be that let's say that E gamma is equal to En minus E1 plus delta E. Okay? So that this is E1, this is En, right? And delta E is some small energy above En. So if you are not already familiar with, you know, what happens in quantum mechanics, your first thought might be, well, maybe the system, the photon comes in with energy E is equal to En minus E1 plus delta E, right? Yeah, I'm sorry about that. I'm really fucking tired of Zoom now. As you can imagine, I'm paying for this out of the institute is not paying for this, but it keeps disconnecting me. So you can imagine my frustration at this. So what you might think might happen is that the photon is first, it is absorbed, and the particle jumps up. Right, the particle goes from E1 to En plus delta E, right? And then, well, it can't exist in the delta E state. So then the particle jumps down to En, and in the process, it emits a photon, which is of energy delta E. So this would be emitted photon, right? But the thing is that this process is not allowed, right? And it's not allowed because delta E, right? This En plus delta E, there is no energy level. It is forbidden. So the particle simply cannot go anywhere. It cannot absorb that photon at all, right? So this is not allowed. So So what happens? The photon comes in and just goes away. It doesn't do anything to the system. Okay? Similarly, if your system is in an excited state, what is the meaning of excited, by the way? Excited means that n is greater than 1. That means it is not in the ground state. That is, it has some energy. Right? And then it jumps down to some state which is lower in energy than the state it is in, right? So it starts in some state En and ends up in some state Em. Now, when this happens, what will happen? It will emit some energy. Right? It will release some energy, and let's say that energy takes the form of a photon. What will be the frequency of the photon? The frequency of the photon will be given by this expression. Right? So a quantized system can only absorb and emit energies, right, which are given by the difference between these discrete energy levels, right? What about a free particle? Does a free particle have this restriction? Free particle does not have this restriction, right? It can absorb and emit any energy because the energy spectrum is continuous. All energies are allowed, right? Okay. So this is one thing, right? System can only emit and absorb discrete frequencies. Or I should say not discrete frequencies, but frequencies compatible with the energy eigenvalues. Right? So in our case, if your particle is in an infinite potential well, those energy eigenvalues are infinite, are discrete. So your particle can only emit or absorb energy in discrete steps, right? Okay. By the way, do you all have class at 9 o'clock?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The second thing, what is the smallest possible energy that your particle can have? Smallest possible energy, E. Is it equal to zero? No. The smallest possible energy is E1. Right? So what this tells you is that your particle can never be. So if you are in a classical, if you imagine, right, you take a bowl, okay? And in this bowl, you put a small marble, okay? Small object. What will happen? This object will roll down, right? It might go up a little bit, but then it will come back down. And eventually it will settle down into the here at the bottom of the bowl, right? And when it settles down there, right, its kinetic energy at this location will be zero, right? And its momentum will also be zero. But if you have a quantum particle, right? So this is a classical particle. For a quantum particle, the particle can never go down to exactly zero. Okay, and there is a very good reason for that. So what will happen? If you start off the particle in a high energy state, like here, it will go down, right? It will go down to some smallest energy state. But then what will happen is that it will stay in this energy state. It will retain some momentum and energy. Right? Why is this? Why is this the case? This is a consequence of the uncertainty principle, which we haven't studied, but we will look at very soon. Right? So the uncertainty principle, you have seen the expression probably. It says that delta x times delta b is greater than or equal to h bar by 2. What is delta x? That is the uncertainty in the position. And we'll discuss this, what it means to be, what it means to be. How do you calculate this, right? This is the uncertainty in the momentum. And so if your particle settles down at the bottom, right? If it's not moving at all, then what will be delta x? Uncertainty in x, delta in x will be zero. Right? Because if it's not moving, that means it is at a fixed position. Right? But if delta x is zero, or you imagine delta x goes to zero, what will happen to delta p? Delta p will be have to be very, very large, right? It will go to infinity. Right? But see, your particle, if you have a particle in a box, right? And I know that my particle is inside this box. So it has to be its location. I know that the location of the particle, if I ask what is the coordinate location of the particle, I know that the particle has to be between 0 and L, right? This is known. I don't know the exact location, but I know this much, no? Right? So if I know that that some object is in some location, right? So let's say that you have some person and you know that that person is within Mangalore city limits. Okay. Then what would you say? You would say that the uncertainty in the position of this person, right, is around the, well, you would say it's 2R, right? About the size of the box that the particle is in, right? It is somewhere in there, but you don't know the exact location. So your ignorance of the location can be, you can say, right? Well, it's somewhere in Mangalore, right? Similarly, this particle is somewhere in this region. So this means that the uncertainty in the position of the particle is less than L. Right? It has to be less than L. But the moment you say that the uncertainty in the position of the particle is less than L, what this tells you is that delta P has to be greater than or equal to H bar divided by 2L. Right? What this means is that the particle will, if you measure the momentum of the particle, you will not get zero. Sometimes you might get zero, right? Sometimes it might be zero, but other times it will not be zero, right? And when you look at all of the measurements, right? And you ask what is the uncertainty in your measurement, in your P, you will find that it's not zero. So this is a consequence of the quantum mechanical nature of the system, right? Okay, now any questions at this point?
Sir, in the particle in a box, if in the ground state, this inequality becomes equality?
No.
Okay.
No. Well, no, I don't know. No, it doesn't. The inequality becomes an equality only for certain special states which are known as coherent states. And a particle, these states, these eigenstates of energy, they are not coherent states. Okay?
Okay, sir.
So now the question that one will ask naturally is, what is delta x and how do you calculate this uncertainty? What is delta x? What is delta p? And then how to calculate them? Okay. So first let's ask, what happens when I make a measurement of my system? Okay. So my particle is in a box. And again, you have to remember that when I draw this vertical, the sides of the box, this just represents the potential and potential energy. Okay. It doesn't represent the physical position of the particle. Why? Because the particle is in a one-dimensional box. Okay. So let's say my particle is in this box, right? And I open this box and I ask, what is the position of the particle? Okay. So I make repeated measurements. What do? Each time I open the box. So this is M is equal to 1, 2, 3, right? This is the measurement. Okay. So the first time, the second time, the third time, and so on. Each time I measure the position of the particle X, and I measure and I ask, what is the momentum P? Fine. Each time I get some answer. X1, P1, X2, P2, right? And so on, Xn, Pn, right? So this is my data set, right? This is my information about the particle. Now, if I give you a data set, right? Any data set, okay? So X1, X2. And this data set, there are n values, right? What can you do? You can define the mean value, right? The average of this object. And what is this called? This is known by the, this is called a random variable, by the way. Right? Whatever it is that you're measuring, X or P or whatever. So you can define the mean value, right? Or the mean or average. What is that? That is equal to sum of Xi divided by n, right? You can define the mean value of the square, right? So mean of the square, that's called I is equal to 1 to n xi square by n, right? Then you can also define the square of the mean. Well, the square of the mean is just this number. This whole quantity squared, right? So in this way, you can define x to the p, mean value, right? X to the p, whatever. P can be anything. It can be 1, 2, it can be 1.5, it doesn't matter. Okay? What else can you do? You can make a plot of these values. So I make a plot, okay? What is the x-axis? X-axis is the value of my random variable. What is my y-axis? Well, my random variable will lie between 0 and L, right? Okay, so these are my limits. Now, what I do is I divide up my interval 0 to L, I divide it up into boxes. Okay. And I have, let's say I have P boxes or P intervals. You will see in a second why you do this, why we divide it up like this. Okay. So what happens? Sometimes I find the particle lies in this interval. Sometimes it lies in this interval, sometimes here, right? But then I keep repeating the measurement, right? What happens? What are these dots? These dots are telling me how many times I found the particle in one of these boxes, right? What does this give me? This gives me something called a histogram. Right? So a histogram tells me the distribution of my data, right? So as an example, you can ask the histogram for any random variable, let's say for height. In a class, right? What will you get? The x-axis is the height. Right? You will get some mean value. And then your height distribution will look something like this, right? Right? It doesn't have to be so smooth. It can go up and down like this, right? And then for some reason, let's say that your students happen to be like exposed to some sort of nuclear radiation. You could happen that they have turned into mutants and they all have very large height, many of them. So you could have something like this also, right? So this is a histogram. It tells you how many students have height within a certain range, right? So this is HN. Each one of these points, each one of these boxes I can label. So this is 1, 2 till how many boxes I have? T boxes, right? So this is H1, H2, and then till HP. So if the person's height is between HP plus delta H and HP, right? Then I take this height and I put it inside this box, whichever box this is. So this should be capital P, sorry. This is small p, right? Small p goes between 1 and big P, right? So this is the index. So this is what a histogram is, right? So if I have a histogram, what does this tell me? This can be used to construct a probability distribution function. So if you imagine doing this for a particle inside a box and the system is in the ground state, okay, what sort of histogram will you get? You will get a histogram which looks like this. Okay, and what is the reason for this? Why does it look like this? Why does it not look like this? Right? Can anybody tell me why it looks like this? Why do I not have like the particles showing up at position L or position 0? Why is it showing up at L is equal to L by 2 so often? The reason is that, remember that my particle is in a state psi which is described, which has the form psi 1 root 2 by L sine pi x by L, right? So it looks like this. There is a my state looks like this, right? And what is psi 1 squared? Psi 1 squared gives me the probability density, right? So if I make a plot of my probability density, I will get something like this. I will get a curve like this, right? So, but if I take one or two measurements, will I get a curve? I will not get a curve, right? I will just get a bunch of discrete points. But if I take lots of measurements, what will happen? The histogram will become more and more fine. It will become more and more detailed. And in the limit that the number of measurements goes to infinity, my histogram will approach this curve. Okay, so I'll stop here for today. Before the next class, please go back and remind yourself what a histogram is and what are all the statistical averages if you don't know, if you don't remember. Okay. And I'll also try to send you some links to some videos which explain these concepts. You, by the way, you can find videos explaining pretty much any concept on YouTube, right? So please make good use of that. All right. Okay, I'll stop the recording.